Caller, go ahead. You're on the air.
Hi, I'm John. I'm Liz Wild's friend. I'm John Kelly from yourinnervoice.com.
John Kelly? Are you
yeah.
Are you the backward speech guy?
I am the backward speech guy.
Okay, so, John, explain to me, all right, explain to everybody what it is that you do.
Well, these studies involve detecting unconscious communications encrypted backwards in human speech. And in order to conduct this kind of a study, we record people talking, and then we monitor those spoken statements played backwards using a digital audio editor. So we play back the audio backwards, and we study the reflection of the signal, so to speak, in order to glean insight into all kinds of different things, like future events or things from the distant past, solving mysteries, or even penetrating deeper into mysterious topics than other channels of information might provide. I've been doing this for years, and famously I reported on issues related to the Iraq War 2 years before it began. I identified the BTK killer in Wichita, Kansas. Dennis Rader, 15 minutes before he confessed. And I did that in Wichita morning radio 15 minutes before he confessed in town. So using this method, it's related to sleep talking. If you guys know any folks who talk in their sleep.
I do.
We know that's unconscious communication. So the unconscious mind can assert a certain amount of control over the speech organs to make them vocalize in different manners. And some of those mannerisms are telling. And we can actually interpret them as lay people. We can hear clearly articulated messages when we listen to backward speech. So what I like to do, not only is talk about this, but I like to demonstrate these speech phenomena. Because
yeah.
I think it's compelling when we listen together. That we can hear these different voices when the audio is played backwards. And one of the topic areas that's fun to listen to is early speech when in childhood development, when children are just developing their speech vocal capabilities. At first they vocalize, and we call it baby babble. But there's more to baby babble than just the babble itself. Let's listen to an example. This is a 23-month-old child. I'm on the phone with the mother. The baby's babbling. We'll hear the baby babble.
Sister says that she's on the phone. She'll keep talking and then she'll laugh at herself and tell you what you do.
Is my level good there? You can hear that?
Yeah, it's pretty good.
Yeah, so the baby babble is clear, but is there something more to it? And I say, yes, there is, because when I play that babble, that clip backwards, I can hear the baby say the words, I spank him.
Okay, that's playing that child backwards.
That is that clip. I'll show you the excerpt here. I've just reversed the time on the graph and played it backwards. Here's the forward sample. Played backwards sounds.
I spank him.
Yes. Yeah, so we're detecting intelligent communications, the signature of intelligent communications through the study of a reflection. You know, the utilization of reflection in different sciences and engineering processes is widely observed. A reflector telescope, for example, is not a means of looking directly at the stars, but rather a way of studying the reflections of their light on a mirrored surface.
Oh, okay. I'm real slow in catching up here. Maybe my mind is backwards. With the child, are we determining that the child is the brain of the child is still developing, thus
it's speaking backwards?
There's something in the brain that hasn't kicked it forward and made it go, well, what we consider forward. I don't want to say dyslexic, but you know what I'm saying? It's just...
Well, the arrow of time, so to speak, in that mental environment may be pointed in a different direction, but eventually we anticipate that the child will become verbose in the normal forward time manner that we all share collectively. But at this stage in development, we are, in spite of the absence, in other words, of indicators of intelligible speech in the babble itself, those indicators of deeper consciousness processes are discovered through a study of the reflection of the signal rather than its manifestation in regular forwards time. So we're suspending time with a snapshot, so to speak, to create a statistical graph of the speech signal. Rather than looking at words on a printed page, we're studying a graphic waveform and its representation on an audio editing computer, on a digital editing station. And in doing so, we're gleaning additional information. Now, it's very difficult at this stage in that child's development to approach that child as a witness and to say, well, we heard you talk about spankings, and we wonder what did you think about that? We can't really get any meaningful feedback necessarily through approaching a child in that way. But there are other situations where people talk backwards where meaningful feedback is also possible. So in a scientific way, we can actually collect feedback when we make assertions such as observations, such as I suspect, you know, that there's more being said in that babble than what may meet us on first observation. Let's go to a famous murder case, a Hollywood murder, which is Bonnie Lee Bakley, the wife of Robert Blake.
Yes.
Robert Blake, mm-hmm. Famous actor, who portrayed Beretta and our gang, a long career in Hollywood. His wife, Bonnie Lee, died of a gunshot wound to her head in a restaurant, in the cab of his vehicle outside of a restaurant in Los Angeles. And Mr. Blake faced a number of trials. He's a free man today, but serious change in his life around the time of those cases and the death of his wife. Bonnie Lee, she used to tape her telephone calls, and she had a variety of associates and concerns in her private business life. So these tapes became public after the trial, and here is Ms. Bakley talking to a friend on the telephone.
But the only thing is, see, I'm only going to be here until, like, February, and then I'm leaving, you know, so I hope it's...
Oh,
fall.
I think you'll come before that.
You better, yeah.
And when I played that clip backwards, I could hear more of that conversation, especially in Miss Bakley's voice. I could hear her say the words, I know he'll murder me.
I know he'll murder me.
Okay, so that's crazy. That was backwards from what she had just said to the other guy on the phone.
This is the telephone recording, and I flipped the signal around, so we're listening to it backwards. And I'll show you the forward segment now where we just detected that message.
And then I'm leaving you.
When she says those words,
and then I'm leaving you.
Unconsciously, she encrypts more information, and we detect that by reversing the signal.
I mean, you're
okay, no. Are, let me ask you something. Is she doing is somebody doing this consciously or subconsciously?
It's parallel to sleep talking, which is unconscious behavior.
Okay, but so who is he?
Well, this is very interesting, isn't it? She does describe a person connected to a murder in the male gender, but she doesn't name names.
Yeah.
She doesn't say specifically. But what does this tell us? It tells us some important investigative information, I believe. For example, she describes the nature of her death, not in terms of suicide, accident, old age, sickness, but in terms of a criminal event, and that it's an indicator that on some level of consciousness she had prescience or foreknowledge of her death as murder. So I find it compelling that in fact she did die in such a way.
Yeah, but she
there were these recordings available to study, you know, in this manner.
Sure, but she had a ton of enemies. It wasn't just Robert Blake who had a problem with her. I mean, there were a lot of other people who were pretty angry.
Well, she had a pretty shady past. I mean, I know that for a fact. But so she's, you know, she was, I don't know. Well, I don't know if he did it or not.
No.
I don't know if he paid somebody to do it or not. I just don't know. What about the Dennis Rader again, the BTK?
Yeah, Dennis. Well, this is a very interesting story. And Mr. Rader was arrested on suspicion by local police in Wichita and held in a county jail awaiting hearing before a judge. And in that time, local television interviewed him by telephone to connect with him and to profile him in the news. He was a former city employee, a ticketing officer for civil infractions. So I guess if you ran your sprinkler too long in your front lawn or something like that, someone like Mr. Rader in that role would have been knocking on your door with a ticket.
Code enforcement.
So let's listen now to Dennis Rader talking about preparing for his, in this pre-hearing stage, he's talking about paperwork and preparing to appear before the judge.
So now that party is going to be subpoenaed in or has been subpoenaed in. If you're not talking to that party, they can't come here and visit them.
Talking about life in the county jail. Well, played backwards, boy, was this ever, it lead to some interesting results. I heard him say the words, the demons influenced that guy. Now, if you're following me so far, that you know, if you accept that I've interpreted those words from that that waveform, so to speak, if we accept that I'm talking about demons and Dennis Rader in the same sentence, why would that be important to the BTK case? Well, it turns out that the authentic killer would write letters to local police and journalists, like television news reporters in Wichita, taunting them and at the same time outlining details of the case that could only be known to someone who was at the scene of the crime. And so the police authenticated those letters as from the original killer or the authentic killer, based on the information that would not have been known to someone who was not involved in the crime scene. So, with that in mind, one of the interesting points of those letters that the killer put into writing was that he described himself as someone who was possessed by a demon. So I said to myself, upon noting this parallel, I said, what are the chances that Mr. Rader could have unconsciously, you know, enunciated in such a way that I could interpret it, that he was talking about demons and possession, or demonic influence, excuse me, and that the known killer who'd been authenticated by the details of his letters was also talking about the same thing, that, you know, it became more and more apparent to me there were strong parallels between Dennis Rader and BTK. So I aired that on Wichita Morning Radio 15 minutes before Mr. Rader was due to appear in court, and upon his appearance in court, he confessed to all the crimes. So it was quite compelling that this means was used to, you know, from a civilian side, this was not in concert with police efforts, but that a civilian thousands of miles away from the events, relying only on the speech signal, could produce meaningful intelligence related to forensic evidence, and that was in fact validated by the speaker himself. You know, I don't have the clip loaded, but Mr. Rader went on the air with the same local television 2 weeks after his confession. And he stated aloud, and I have the recording, he said that he felt that he was, in fact, possessed by a demon.
Oh, okay. You have the recording that he says he was possessed by a demon?
Yes, I do. And if you allow me the moments while we were talking, I will load that clip, and we'll listen to it together.
Sure. Whatever you want to play. I mean, yeah, this is just, this is freaky is what it is. It's the best term I can come up with.
Yeah,
I have more questions for you, but you can just play whatever sound bites you want to play. Just, you know, it's up to you.
Sure. Yeah, that's fine. And so, again, I'm saying that I have experience reporting on cases of regional or national significance in the United States, as well as, and in the course of that reporting over the years, details that I released through the, you know, detection and reporting of the messages that I heard in the encrypted in those voices were validated by different people like sheriff's department insiders in Colorado who were investigating Kobe Bryant's case. Actually, the news talk radio in Denver who interviewed me told me that their connections to the sheriff's department were validating all these forensic insider details that I was reporting from the messages. So I have experience, even just in this simple venue, like not in a court of law, but in the public arena, where validating information has come back, supporting my claims. So let's go now to Dennis Rader's demon confession. This is the backup clip of Mr. Rader himself talking about his perceptions of the nature of his demonic possession.
The dark side of me that it controls me. I personally think.
I actually think it's a demon.
Demons,
there you go. So from thousands of miles distance, I was able to derive a meaningful interpretation of Mr. Rader's, and profiling him, so to speak, relying only on these reflections encrypted in the speech signal. So this kind of verification would be very difficult to produce by chance, and, you know, it have so many coordinated such a coordinated chain of evidence, so to speak, and the fact that my reporting was issued publicly and heard potentially tens of or hundreds of thousands of listeners heard my report given prior to Mr. Rader's confession. So although I wasn't acting as an agent of any police agency at that time, as a civilian, I was able to make those interpretations to demonstrate the scope and the potential of this type of interrogative tool in terms of producing reliable information. I would say it's a very high success rate to be able to coordinate not only detection but the delivery of the information in such a meaningful way locally to the residents who were affected by that story. And it was also my experience some years later, that I was interviewed in Ontario, Canada, and the production staff on that show were actually related to the 6 o'clock news journalists in Wichita who were receiving those threat letters and letters of intimidation from Dennis Rader at that time. So the karma, so to speak, or the synchronicity, of these incidents ties people together in unexpected ways. And this backward speech, secret message connection is unanticipated, and yet it seems authentic from a variety of perspectives.
Okay. All right. Well, that brings me to my next question. We were leading up to this. We heard the baby talk about I spank him. We heard Bonnie Bakley talk about, she thinks she's going to be murdered. He's going to kill me. We heard Dennis Rader. Now, what about, have you heard anything or deciphered anything on a national security level? And if so, have you brought it to anyone's attention?
Well, certainly, if you consider preparations for war relevant to national security, and because my coverage of the 2001 inaugural address of President George W. Bush was revealing in such a way, and so I reported on hundreds of interviews over a period of time leading up to the incident or the events that initiated the war in Iraq. On this issue, and it just so happened that the intelligence was real. Here's President George W. Bush in his remarks from the presidential inauguration of January 21st, 2001.
And to all nations, we will speak for the values that gave our nation birth.
And in reverse, I heard the president say the words, Mission of Baghdad.
Mission of Baghdad. Mission of Baghdad.
I'd like to have that on a loop.
Number 9.
Play it on my show. I like that.
Sounds
all right.
Better than when he talks forward. With
that analysis, has anyone from the government ever approached you? Has any, Secret Service, CIA, has anybody from the government come and tapped you on the shoulder and says, we need to talk?
Well, quite frankly, because of the complexities of our modern-day world related to issues such as secrecy and privacy and human rights and war crimes, we live in a complex environment where there was a very high level of permissiveness in the United States for the offering me access to public broadcasting. I was on CBS television. I was in all kinds of international radio, BBC, Deutschland Radio Berlin. So it seems to me, my understanding was that there was a lot of green lights that were flashed in support of my being allowed to continue to share information with the public. At the same time, the security mechanisms that exist in our society were also active, and I became more and more aware of the different the security infrastructure that overlaps between civilian media, civilian journalism, commercial in the commercial world, military, and all these different roles that exist. So certainly, I've had I've been sensitized to the different levels of security that exist in society. But the fact that I'm allowed to speak freely and to participate today, and you guys are on terrestrial radio, is an indicator that at the same time, there is support for me to continue to broadcast and to talk about these issues in public, because if that support wasn't there, well, my voice simply wouldn't be heard.
Oh, well, aside from my show, where else is your voice heard?
Well, the archive for my three-hour interview on Coast to Coast AM is still on the Coast to Coast AM website, and that is the most heard overnight talk show in the United States.
Yeah.
And that interview has been up since 2003. So,
is that the old Jim Bohannon show?
No. It's Coast to Coast with Art Bell. Art Bell used to host it back in the day.
But I went on to do a lot of independent broadcasting in the last 5 years, and so I began to produce newscasts online, UFO AM, which is a morning newscast on my YouTube channel. I write a column for Examiner.com that's very widely distributed. In fact, my coverage of President Medvedev's UFO comments in Russia late last year was a top-ranked story on Google News. So I continue to publish a column and to broadcast online, as well as I'm involved in documentary production, and I'm involved in a project in continuing education called EXO University, which is an online educational venue for video classes that focus specifically on areas such as psi sciences, exopolitics, and exobiology. So I'm accessible through my website, yourinnervoice.com. I offer private clinical sessions by telephone. And I continue to be involved in publishing and all kinds of other areas, media production. Because I've known Liz Wild over a number of years, who was a broadcaster in Florida, just by fortuitous circumstances, she alerted me to your show and invited me to get in touch with you fellows. So it was, just by having so much support from people in media and different levels of society, I continue to make great connections.
Hey, I appreciate Liz reaching out to you and having you reach out to us. I mean, this is great. I mean, I could spend all night talking about this and the various aspects and levels. Of course, I immediately focused on national security. Is there anything, well, like the baby, is there anything that you've encountered that's more lighthearted? Like, have you ever heard a celebrity say something, or and when you play back, you're like,
because I have all this content. It's very funny. I haven't loaded it, but I will. I'll bring some of this up. Because it is very humorous, and it's unexpected, the ironies of life, so to speak, in some of the best comedy, people say the most unexpected things, and the backwards messages can certainly serve up some hilarity. I'm just typing in to bring up some clips here for you guys. But yeah, I covered celebrity-related news, Hollywood-related news, music stars in the past, but as well as business news. And with all the turmoil in the business world, as some congressional hearings, including Enron, where parties refused to speak, they took the fifth before Congress. They made opening remarks, and in those brief statements, there were still messages that were source of much humor. I'm just loading clips. I'm sorry that I'm on short notice here too.
John, have you ever analyzed any recordings of yourself?
Yes, because in my clinical work, I talk to the clients, I interview them, so I get to monitor how I'm responding to the things that they're discussing. I have lots of self-reflection that goes with this. I don't know if I have anything newsworthy or funny to report. You could certainly investigate that from this interview, but
no, I'm actually very curious about
what
I'm saying.
Right now.
I was just
sitting here thinking what would be really funny to hear this last 25 minutes played backwards.
I think I got a program that'll flip the audio and we'll play it backwards.
I'm pretty sure Mick would be. I got 99 problems when I pitch anyone.
No, I think, if you heard us arguing, I think if you played it backwards, it says, I'm just really saying, I gotta pee. I gotta pee. I gotta pee.
I gotta get out of this chair.
Well, fellas, I did find some humor in my collection, so I'm going to play for you now red carpet interview with Maria Shriver.
Okay.
And former California Governor Arnold Schwarzenegger, her husband. She's talking about their taste in movies. This is from the Wayback Machine. This is about 2000 Academy Awards red carpet
interview. I know that you two don't agree on politics. Do you agree on favorite movies this time around?
Yeah, a lot of the movies that are nominated were some of our favorites, so we do. We agree sometimes on politics. He's not as conservative as you think.
Arnold, not as conservative as we might think, but apparently Maria had some other things in mind. Arnold was more to her than just a brainiac. In fact, I heard her say backwards, I simply wish he was stupid.
A few feet was there, man.
I think she got her wish.
Well, there you go.
That is good. I like that.
What do wives say about their husbands and husbands say about their wives? There's all kinds of different insight. Well, when I work with couples, then I'll interview each separately, and I'll communicate with each of them about their messages and what they might be sharing or we might be able to pick up on. You know, sometimes in relationships, we sort of get accustomed and habituated to each other, and then the scope of our understanding sometimes is, you know, we have a little bit of narrow vision. Having someone intervene periodically in the role of a counselor, at least to get a third perspective, can help people to see each other in a new light and to build strong bonds in families, which in these times people need each other. So backward speech has a role not only in helping parents understand their children, but in couples understanding each other. And you know, sometimes people go through intense experiences together. You know, one couple that went through a very intense experience in modern 20th century history was Betty and Barney Hill, who were famous for their experience of abduction with extraterrestrials. You guys are probably familiar with their unexpected journey.
Okay, yeah. Yep.
Mm-hmm. Well, this couple was traveling from Canada. They were returning on vacation in the Northeast and traveling south at night when they had perceptions of lights in the sky, and that led to what has become a very famous abduction story. And so Betty Hill, in the years that followed, gave a lot of interviews, including this one from the early 1990s, talking a little bit about when they started to sense what they saw was a UFO.
Yes, if I did a watch of eagle flight, and he tried to identify this. And it's flying in a very erratic manner. This is very puzzling to us. But this is 61. We heard UFO. Well, actually, in those days, they called them flying saucers. We had no idea what a flying saucer looked like. But we went. But we had no fear, just curiosity. We were trying to identify this craft.
So at that stage in their encounter, they were still puzzled. They hadn't really gotten very close. They hadn't become a close encounter, so to speak. And yet, there's information here, you know, that tells us more about Betty Hill's testimony, because lots of people hear about these things and they think, well, they're just making it up. You know, it's just a circus. But is there more to her testimony? Are there telltale signs hidden backwards in her voice? And I think there was something here that was interesting, because I heard her say the words, "The saucer, I'll block it." So when someone doesn't want to remember something because it was a difficult experience, sometimes they will want to block the memory.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Right. Yeah.
And so I thought that was very interesting. That while this was someone who was known for giving her testimony, and she appeared on many different television shows, film, and so on. It's a very famous story. This wasn't something that gave her great comfort in its retelling. And I think that says something about a person's integrity, because why would someone perpetuate, a lie, so to speak, if it gave them such personal discomfort? Wouldn't the point be, you know, to not torture yourself decades later? It could only be, in my imagination, that there's more. It's quite authentic. And in fact, there was a scientist on, I think it was History Channel, had a broadcast late last year, a scientist who had a sample from Betty Hill's dress at the time that the dress she wore the night of the abduction.
Right.
She had stowed this dress away and had not washed it. And so there was material that was found on the dress by this scientist working in a lab. I think he's a chemist, materials chemist or industrial chemist. And she said this was anomalous material. There were indicators, physical indicators, in other words, or physical evidence related to this case of the Hills that's only just seeing, you know, light of day now. So it's not only, in other words, my belief that she's telling the truth, but there are scientific reasons to believe that Miss Hill, that the Hills had an encounter with something really unusual.
Well, let me ask you something in a related vein here. Are you familiar with the individual known as George Van Tassel?
Yeah, George Van Tassel and the Rock in Joshua Tree down in Southern California.
Yes, okay. His nephew was on last week or the week before, and he's making a movie about his uncle and Giant Rock. It's called simply Giant Rock the Movie. And so we were learning a lot about George Van Tassel and his encounters with UFOs and out there at Giant Rock and whatnot. And so he's making a movie about his uncle, which I hope to have a cameo in at least, you know, small little part. I'm trying to get in the movie. I'm wondering.
What is your connection to this? The production itself, you just because you know the guy, or do you have a deep interest in UFOs?
No, because he was a guest on my show promoting the movie, so no, I just thought it was an interesting. I thought it was an interesting project. I thought his uncle was a very interesting character. I think it's a great story that needs to be told. You know, I mean, it's not your typical car chase, explosion, action film that comes out every 5 minutes in Hollywood. So I thought, well, this is kind of a cool topic that, you know, you don't see all the time. So why not make a film about it? So he's very deep he's in it. He's not in to exploit it. He really wants to show his uncle in a positive light.
I met people connected with, I believe it was the society that congregated around George Van Tassel.
Yes.
I met them about a dozen years ago in San Diego, and these people were very serious, and they said, in fact, they had a tremendous archive of unpublished material. So I wonder how related this movie project may be to tapping in or leveraging off this apparent wealth of information that was unknown. In other words, you know, how the public experiences the UFO phenomenon is something like sort of a flash in the pan, you know, 30-second news spot, and then they're off to something else. Mr. Van Tassel is a contactee, is he a nut job or whatever? There's not a lot of time for the public to assimilate or investigate or evaluate these things. But when I heard how much material they had, it really impressed me, you know, that there were a lot of dynamics and a lot of history. There was a lot of depth to that case, in other words, that wasn't known generally. So I think this is a very good idea.
Well,
where
you come in, where I'm there's a million things for you to analyze, but I was just thinking that if you go to YouTube, he's done interviews back in the 50s and the 60s with, you know, television stations, so you can actually hear his voice. He's got recorded material of his voice. I wonder if we play that backwards, if we can find something interesting.
Well, I think it's an excellent suggestion. I should have thought of that myself. I have, as you saw, I have Betty Hill, and I've listened to other contactees' testimonies where I could find them. I have just some timeline of cases that I've looked at, but I think Van Tassel is a very interesting subject, and that could be a little more than revealing. You know, it's not uncommon for people connected with the subject to talk about aliens and even specific types of entities. Like, you're probably familiar with, in recent years, Henry McElroy, the New Hampshire state legislator,
right,
who upon his retirement, he gave an informal statement on camera. And he's testified on camera that he had seen a memo to President Eisenhower related to meetings with extraterrestrials.
Right, yeah.
So I listened to the soundtrack to see if Mr. McElroy would reveal anything else. And, of course, I did find something of interest. Here's Henry McElroy's statement.
And it informed President Eisenhower the continued presence of extraterrestrial beings here in the United States of America.
And I thought this was very compelling because the message came out as the alien, the Greys.
The alien, the Greys.
So not only is the message talking about extraterrestrials, which is tapped into the, you know, what he was talking about consciously, meetings with extraterrestrials and President Eisenhower, but he's taking it a step further, because now he's talking about a species, which is why we discussed in the UFO field, which is the gray extraterrestrial. So he's talking about aliens as grays and possible related gray ET contacts with President Eisenhower. I mean, this is an investigative tool, as you suggested, to people close to this topic, people who are the contactees. They have more to say. In fact, I Pascagoula in Mississippi, I think a lot about that case and the testimonies that were gathered there from the early 1970s. And I have those clips here. Charles Hickson was one of the witnesses. This was a case, again, that received a lot of publicity about two gentlemen fishing the side of the river and having a contact with a really bright UFO and apparently an abduction that went with that. So they weren't attention seekers. They were simply people caught in the middle of events. They agreed to go to the police, and then from their statements to the sheriffs, the news got wind of it, the media got wind of it, and it became an international story. This is Charles Hickson from that time, 1973, 1975, an on-site interview.
Well, we talked it over here and decided we would call the sheriff's department, and the sheriff said, I'm supposed to come on over there if we talk about it. So we stayed there for several hours talking with him and him questioning. And the sheriff promised me that it wouldn't any news media know anything about it, that he would try to get it to the proper authorities if he could find out who the proper authority was. And
so again, we can hear from his statement, it's not attention-seeking, it's a man caught up in the middle of circumstances. What does his secret message tell me? I heard the words, they knew an alien.
They knew an alien.
It appears to verify his statement as being true, that he had contact with something that his unconscious would describe as extraterrestrial or alien in this way.
Well, okay. We're going to have to wrap things up. We're off the air in a couple of minutes. Is there any way we can have you on in the future?
I would like to spend more time with you in a formal interview setting, and we could talk about all the fine details of the subject.
Absolutely, and I think it'd be great. I'm going to get in touch with Chad Meek, the nephew of George Van Tassel, and I will give him an excerpt from the interview we just had with you, and let him listen. I think he's going to get a big kick out of it, and he would love to get some audio of his uncle backwards and have it analyzed, because he's a big UFOologist, fan. What do you call them? UFO?
Yeah, UFO researcher. I think that's a great, that's an awesome connection. I really appreciate you reaching out to help me get this work in front of that fellow.
Yeah, that'd be great, and we'd love to have you on again. If somebody wants to get a hold of you, where do they get a hold of you?
My website is Your Inner Voice, yourinnervoice.com, and my toll-free number is 1-888-453-0751, 1-888-453-0751, John Kelly at yourinnervoice.com.
And John is J-O-N.
J-O-N.
J-O-N, John Kelly. And can they also find you on Facebook and places like that?
Yeah, John Kelly on Facebook, J-O-N-K-E-L-L-Y, Secret Message TV on YouTube, Vancouver UFO Examiner for examiner.com. So I'm out there. I'm on the radar. Links to all of those projects off of yourinnervoice.com as well.
And our thanks to our dear friend Liz Wild for asking you to call in. I really appreciate it. We'd love to have
you
on again.
Wonderful.
Thank you, John.
Thanks, John.
Thank you. Okay, good.
Wow, that was that's how I want to.
The baby creeped me out.
That's how I want to wrap up the show.
I got to tell you, man, the first 5 minutes on the phone, I thought that was the voice of Anonymous.
Voice of Anonymous.
Yes.
Who's Anonymous?
It's the hacking.
Oh, the hacker group.
The hacking group.
Oh, okay. Hey, listen, folks, we've only got a minute left, so we're going to go ahead and wrap things up. You'll catch us here next Wednesday live, and that's from 8 to 11 Eastern Time. You can find us on Facebook. We are simply, find us simply as The Mix Show. Go to The Mix Show page, hit the like button, contact us if you'd like. We're also on Twitter. That's The Mix Show. And if you want to email us, it's, of course, The Mix Show. But where? At yahoo.com. So The Mix Show Facebook, The Mix Show Twitter, The Mix Show at yahoo.com. Our thanks to John Kelly, Liz Wild, and who else are we thanking?
Dan
living in his car in New York.
Dan,
calling
Dan the homeless man.
That's right. Telling it like it is.
Homeless Dan.
Homeless Dan. I love it. So it was great having him, and love to get John Kelly back on again.
Special thanks to the NOW.
That's right, National Organization of Women. I expect to hear from them. So anytime soon, and I'm petitioning hard to get Charles Manson paroled for the next what is it? Inauguration. I already forgot what the hell it was.
I thought you were going to say Mix Show.
Yeah.
If a Republican is elected, it will be appropriate to have someone like that there.
Okay, your mic is off. You can go to hell. All right, folks, we'll catch you next week. Have a good one.